First of all, I'd like to thank organizers for inviting me to this nice conference and give me an occasion to stay here for 2 months. Today I'm going to talk about KP2 equation, which is actually this equation. This equation is very close to the KdV equation. Here we have x derivative of KdV equation and some other terms here, which takes into the slow variation of the motion of waves in the transversal direction. And here sigma is a parameter which is related to the surface tension. If sigma is a positive number, it means that surface tension is weak, and we call it KP2 equation, and that's what I'm going to talk today. And if sigma equals minus 1, it is called KP1 equation. And in that case, surface tension is presumed to be, is assumed to be strong. And let phi sub c be this function, leading this way, then phi sub c of x minus 2 times c times t is actually a one-soliton solution of this KdV equation. And Kp equation is the model to explain transversal stability or instability of KdV soliton in the 2D setting. And for that purpose, equation was derived by Kadmotsev and Petviashvili in 1970, and they also did some formal analysis of stability of line solitons there. And actually, both KdV and Kp equations are known to be integrable system. And this is a photograph I followed from the website of Professor Alfrovitz, which is a picture of the ocean. And here are many waves which are uniform in transversal direction of the motion, and they are crossing. And actually, Kp equation are also used to describe the intersection of line soliton waves. But today, I'm only talk about stability of one line soliton. So in my talk, there does not appear any intersection of solitons. And first, I'd like to introduce conservation laws of KP2 equation. And in the conservation law, I use this notation, which is defined by Fourier transform eta divided by c times u hat, the Fourier transform u. And the inverse Fourier transform of this quantity is defined in this way. And apparently, as KdV equation, Elton norm is conserved for localized solution. And moreover, it has a Hamiltonian, which is written in this form. And actually, the Kp equation I wrote in the previous slide is formally equivalent to the flash derivative of this Hamiltonian multiplied by this Q adjoint operator ddx. And formally, it's easy to see that this quantity is preserved, and this quantity is also preserved. And for KP1 equation, actually, when sigma equals minus 1, the first two terms has the same sign. And as a result, there are a paper in the next slide, I explain that there is a grand state, which was proved by Andvor and so. But for KP2 equations, the first two terms has opposite. Although this term is zeroth order, actually, in terms of scaling, y derivative is equivalent to the x derivative, twice of x derivative. So this term has the same scaling order with this one. So these two terms are the principal term of this Hamiltonian. And for KP2 equation, both those two terms have opposite sign. For this reason, this Hamiltonian is not so useful to estimate time global quantities. On the other hand, this one is quite useful. And also for line soliton, it is quite useful. And actually, around line soliton, this quantity is almost preserved. And we can prove it if we prove that the modulation parameters, which I will introduce later, has a good decay estimate. And before I introduce non-results on Kp equation, I would like to introduce some famous results on stability of KdV1 solitons. Actually, there are not many, but I think these three results are quite famous. And the first one is Lyapunov stability of one solitons in the energy class. And the argument is use both L2 conservation law and also the Hamiltonian for the KdV equation. Unfortunately, such an argument doesn't work because of the bad nature of Hamiltonian for KP2 equation. So unfortunately, this argument doesn't work. The second one is to prove asymptotic stability of one solitons of KdV equations in exponential weighted space. What Pego and Weinstein did is to use some semigroup estimate in exponential weighted space. Usually in L2 space, because KdV is a Hamiltonian system, we cannot expect decay estimate in L2 space. But in weighted L2 space, the weight function, if the weight function reflects the motion of waves, we can have some kind of decay estimate. I'm sorry. I stand here. And later by Martin and Mel, they proved asymptotic stability of KdV solitons in H1. And the key in their paper was the Villier identity as well as Liouville theorem. And in this talk, I don't use Liouville theorem because I don't do classification argument, but the Villier identity, the usage of Villier identity by them was quite useful in the argument of KP2 ether. And for L2 stability of lines 1 solitons, it was proved by Mel and Vega in 2003. And what they did is basically by using the mirror transformation, which is sort of background transformation, they connect soliton solutions with King solutions of defocusing modified KdV equations. And by using another mirror transformation, they map King solutions of modified KdV to new solutions. And actually, they gave a local isomorphism between these typical solutions. So as a result, it gives a local isomorphism in L2 sense between the neighborhood of zero and the neighborhood of one solitons. So this is the idea. And this argument cannot be applied directly to the stability of line solitons in L2, R2, but the idea is still useful to investigate linear stability of line solitons. So the next slide is known results for KP equations. And linear stability for KP2 equation, of course, there is a formal argument by Kadmotsev and Petviashvili, but somehow mathematical argument was done by Petviashvili first. What he did is by using inverse scattering theory, he finds some resonant continuous eigenmoods which is related to dynamics of modulating line solitons. And later, Alexander and Pego and Sachs proved that in L2 space, if you linearize the operator of KP2 equations along line solitons, do not have any eigenvalues or continuous spectrum other than on imaginary axis. So they proved neutral stability. And such a result was also proved by Mariana Haragas in 2010 on this setting. So they used periodicity in X variable, and they considered Y variable in the whole line. And also there is a result by Villanova and Abrovitz, who constructed a formula on solutions along line solitons by using inverse scattering theory. And what I did with Svetskov in 2012 is to use mirror transformation as well is for the KP2 equation. Idea is almost the same with Mel and Vega. And in this case, the method of Mel and Vega worked very well because there's no resonance in the spectrum. And actually, in this case, the mirror transformation gives local isomorphism in L2 sense. And there is also several results on KP1 equation, but since there are so many results, I only introduce some of them. The first one is done by Zaharov in 1975. What they did is to find an unstable eigenmoors for linearized operator, and he proved linear instability. And later, the Russian and Zvetskov investigate the instability of planar solitons for Hamiltonian system in quite a systematic way, and they prove also nonlinear stability instability. And why? So for KP2 equation, it is expected that line soliton is stable. On the other hand, line soliton is expected to be unstable in R2 for KP1 equation. Why is the situation so different? Because the, I think it's related to the difference of the sign of a Hamiltonian here. Here we have different sign of Hamiltonian, and it relates a lot. And actually, for KP1 equation, it has a stable ground state. It was proved by Dubois and so. And for the well-portness, the first result on well-portness was obtained by Ukai in 1989, and later by Brugan using Fourier restriction theorem by himself. He proved well-portness of KP2 equation in this setting. And later, Morine, So, Takaoka, Zvetskov, and I forget to write many other people, but they improved Brugan's result in many boundaries. They proved similar results like this in different boundary conditions. And what I use today is the two well-portness result along line solitons. And it was proved by Morine and so on, Zvetskov in this year. And what they prove is that if you add some L2 perturbation to this line soliton at t equals 0, then the difference between solution and line soliton stay in L2 space. And this quantity is continuous in L2 norm with respect to time. And my talk is also related to normal results on heat equations, so I want to introduce some of them. And the typical one is the stability of one king solution of this heat equation in Rn. If n equals 1, it has a king solution which moves with a constant speed. And actually, phi prime is an, since this solution is, equation is translation invariant, it has a traveling wave which doesn't, and its spatial derivative belongs to the kernel of the linearized operator. So if you write the spectrum of the linearized operator for n equal 1 case, then the spectrum is like this. So there is an isolated eigenvalue 0. And all the other spectrum locates in stable half frame, and there is a spectral gap. But if you think of the transverse stability of this traveling wave, so it means that it's uniform in, we extend this king solution of one-dimensional king solution to uniformly to the transversal direction and think of stability. And then what happens is that if you think of the spectrum for, in this case, because thanks to the transversal direction, there appears some extra spectrum which converges to zero here. So here is continuous spectrum. And zero is not an isolated eigenvalue anymore. Of course, there should be some stable spectrum here either. But anyway, if you think of the transversal stability of king solution for this equation, there appears some continuous spectrum like this. And if you want to investigate the dynamics of solution, we make use of this ansatz and substitute this formula into this equation. Then we get a solution of heat. Then we find that the gamma satisfies a heat equation of n minus one dimensional. So the original problem was in n dimensional, and the motion of this one is described by n minus one dimensional heat equation, and it decays in this rate. And also there is a related result in Hamiltonian system, which was obtained by Kukanian. What he did is think of this wave equation, and think of transversary stability of one-dimensional kink. Again, this translation value, this function is the describer of PDE, which is one-dimensional smaller, which locates in two-dimensional in this case, because the original problem was three-dimensional, and this one is and this satisfies a 2D wave equation. And because this is a solution of 2D wave, it is expected to converge. Gamma tends to zero as t goes to infinity. And now I want to return to the KP2 equation. To analyze KP2 equation, I make use of answers of this form. Here, C is basically the amplitude of line soliton, but it depends on not only on time t, but it also depends on transversal direction y. And also, the phase parameter here depends not only on t, but also on transversal direction. So if you think the cross-section view of line solitons using this formula, it means that the center of the cross-section view is here, x of ty, and c of ty means the local amplitude of line solitons. And if you observe the crest of line solitons from the line soliton, then it because x of ty depends also on transversal parameter y, it is not necessarily a straight line, but it's close to a straight line. So if we think of the y derivative of x, this basically means the angle. Basically means this angle. And now I want to introduce my result. First, U starts with a line soliton plus some small perturbation, which is written as an x derivative of L2 function, and whose norms are small in this sense. So H1 norm is small, and also the minus half derivative of V0 locates in L2, and this L2 norm is small. And with this assumption, there exists some modulating parameters C and X, such that U of TXY is always close to this modulating line soliton all the time. And the difference of L2 norm between these two is order of the L2 norm of V0. And also, if you think of the difference between this modulation parameter CTY and the original amplitude of line soliton, its difference is in HK norm in Y is also of this order for all the time. And if you think of the angle of line soliton, it's x sub y, and if we square this quantity and integral it on the entire domain, we also have this quantity. So x sub y norm, the x and the hk norm of actually L2 is enough, but L2 norm of x sub y is this order for all the time. And this just says that x sub t is almost close to 2 times c. So basically, x sub t means the speed of the motion of a line soliton wave. So it has this condition. And also, if we think of y derivative of this one, or x sub yy of the norm of x sub yy, it tends to zero as t goes to infinity. So this means that, so combining these two results, we can say that in an infinity sense, this one converges to original speed as t goes to infinity. And also we have some local convergence like this one. If we choose a correct phase shift here, then the difference between these two converges to zero, at least locally in space. So this just means that The last one means that this is x direction, and this is a line solution, and it's so it's moving. And if you see things in the moving coordinate, so this is xty. This line is xty minus r. So in this local frame here, we have asymptotic stability of line solitons. And the first assumption I made here is almost the same with this assumption. That is the integral of v0 along the axis, which along the line, which is parallel to the y-axis, is equal to 0 for all y. This is the assumption I made in this theorem. And actually, we can replace this assumption by this assumption. So if the perturbation v0 decays polynomially in space, it's enough. So this is what I write. If instead of assuming some smallness of this norm, we can assume smallness of this norm. And if we have smallness of this norm, we have the same sort of result. And this is a remark, so which I explained already, so I skip. It says that basically, my theorem says that the line soliton converge, if you perturb line solitons, it converges locally to the original line soliton as t goes to infinity with some phase shift, which doesn't depend on y. But if we see things, here we limit ourselves to this domain. So this is on the, at least for y, this is for compact set. And if we see things in entire line along y-axis, things will be different. This is another my result. And to obtain this result, I assume that perturbation is exponentially localized. And if perturbation is exponentially localized, and also in it is L1 in some direct, the perturbation is in L1, what we have is that the difference between the modulating speed of line soliton and the original speed, or the angle of the crest of the line soliton is a linear combination of the self-similar solution of the Vargas equation at the first order. This is the result. And here this one means, I mean these two notations by this function. And actually this one is a self-similar solution of this Vargas equation. So if you think of the dynamics of modulating line solitons, its dynamics is described by Vargas equation. That's what I want to say. And actually this theorem can be proved by using theory of Kawashima on Vargas type equations. And this kind of observation was not first done by me myself, but actually there was a work by physicist Peterson who showed that similar result can be obtained for Buzinesque systems. And since Buzinesque systems and the KP2 equation are quite similar, I think that this type of result can be obtained for many other Buzinesque equations, at least they describe the case where the surface tension of the water wave is small. And this is a heuristic picture of what I wrote in the previous slide. So if I integrate this formula in y once, what we have is heuristically like this. At least around the center of the y equals, around the compact region, in the compact region of y equals 0, x behaves, x of ty becomes flatter and flatter as t goes to infinity. But I don't have any estimates actually here, around here, because this region is extending in linear order in T. And but what the previous theorem says that this part can be written by an integral of the self-similar solutions of Varga's equation. So as a result, we have some, there should appear some gap here. So there should be a small difference of height here and here. And if we estimate the L2 norm of difference of modulating line solitons and original line solitons here, then we should have some sort of instability in L2. So that's what we have here. If you just think of all line solitons, the set of all line soliton solutions, the set, then there should exist a solution of KP2 equation whose difference between the set of all line soliton solutions and solution itself becomes close at least in this rate. And this happens because if we disregard modulation equation, I said that it's a Varga's system, but if we derive the modulation equation on x and t, c, and if we disregard diffraction term, actually it's a kind of diffusion term, then it becomes a wave equation like this one, and it can be written. Then the solution can be written by using the D'Alembert formula in this way. And because of this term, there appears some phase shift like here, this here. So this kind of result, this theorem is peculiar to the case when the modulation equation is described to the 1D wave equation. Mm-hmm. And now I'd like to explain the strategy of the proof. First, I want to recall the result by Pego and Weinstein for KdV equation. And what they did is to prove stability of family of line solitary waves in this set, in this weighted space. And if you linearize the KdV equation around one soliton solution, we obtain this with the spectrum of the linearized operator is has eigenvalue 0 here. So this is for KdV in weighted space. The spectrum of KdV in weighted space. So anyway, it has a spectrum at the origin. And because of the weight, so the continuous spectrum moves to the stable half plane, and the spectrum is a sum of this isolated eigenvalue and this stable one. This happens because any oscillation tails of KdV solution moves slower than the main solitary wave of KdV. And also, if the solitary wave is smaller, then the propagation speed is smaller than the main solitary wave. So what happens in the weighted space is that the weight function grows exponentially. And suppose this is a center here. And main soliton moves with the same speed with the center of line soliton. Is the center of one soliton. So if there is a smaller solitary wave, the propagation speed is much smaller. And that means that when the center of this wave function moves, this wave is getting smaller and smaller. Yes. Thank you. And because if we add some extra term, something like this, actually it stabilizes solitary wave more. So if we linearize the KP2 equation around u equals 0, then we have this dispersion relation. And if we compute the xc derivative of this omega, then we have the group velocity. And the first two terms is exactly the same as KdV. And the latter one has negative sign. So this also means that if there are some oscillating tail for KP2 equations, the such oscillation, the propagation speed of oscillation, the oscillating tail should be slower than that of KdV, and which means that those waves are also exponentially stable in weighted space. Actually, we have, if you think of this solution of this equation, we have exponential stability in weighted space. But as with the same with heat equation, there should appear some effect of transversal diffraction. And actually, for the KP2 equation, there appears some continuous spectrum of the shape of parabola which goes through zero. And if we truncate this spectrum, then we have the same exponential stability as solution of the linearized equation around zero. So that is the first step. And to work in exponentially weighted space, I need to interpret what the antiderivative means in this space. If the function u is a derivative of L2 function, then the antiderivative of u can be written in this way by using this integral. And since the compact continuous function with compact support, since the intersection of continuous function of compact support and the x derivative L2 function is dense in this exponentially weighted space, and also this integral gives a bounded operator in this weighted space, we can extend this formula directly to the weighted space. So this is how we interpret the antiderivative in exponential weighted space. And then this is the formulas. So for KP2 equations, I wrote that this is KPP, but if you think of KP2 equation, there appears some continuous spectrum here. And if you cut off these continuous modes, then we have exponential stability. That is the result here. So there are continuous eigenmodes like this one for a joint linearized equation, linearized operator. And if we cut off continuous modes, which are in these places, then we have exponential stability like this one. And now I want to derive modulation equations for the motion of modulating, to describe the motion of modulating line soliton. So let us use these answers like this. This is a modulating line soliton, and this one is a perturbation term, and this is an auxiliary function. And this function is needed because if we substitute something like this into KP2 equation, what happens is that we have something like this one. So, and if we compute this quantity, there appears something like this term. So this is the integral of function. And this function tends to zero as x goes to infinity, but it tends to constant as x goes to minus infinity. So this one is problematic to think of. If it remains as it is, we cannot say that V remains in L2 for all the time. So I use this adjustment to ensure which satisfies. And this function is a lot of freedom to choose, but anyway, I need to choose that the difference of these two is equal to the sum mass of this function. The mass of phi sub c. So with this adjustment, we can show that v stays in L2 for all the time, and to analyze stability in exponential weighted space, I need to truncate some small parts. And what I want to do is, this one is not in exponentially weighted space. This one doesn't belong to exponential weighted space. So I want to remove something further so that this one belongs to exponential weighted space. And the candidate of that one is a small solution of the KP2 equation, whose initial data is exactly equal to the perturbation which is added to line solitons. And if we decompose the remainder time V into a sum of V1 and V2 in this way, since the mass of V2, V1 is very small, what is expected is that, so here is a line solution, and V1 is very small, so its propagation speed is small. So what is expected is that this one locates far behind line solitons. And if we subtract this component, then the rest of the term belongs to exponentially weighted space. And since V1 is a solution to the KP2 equation, we can use any known result for small solutions. And for this one, for this V2, I use exponentially stability results by exponentially stability of semigroup. And to use exponential stability of the semigroup, I need, I need to cut off continuous eigenmodes, which belongs to this continuous spectrum. So I need to impose some assumptions like this one. So this is a adjoint eigenmodes of the linearized operator. So if V2 is orthogonal to this one, if we presume that V2 is orthogonal to this one, we can apply the semigroup estimate to V2. And to do this, we choose parameters C and X from this L2 space, the subspace of L2, whose Fourier transform has a compact support. And actually, I take eta 0 to be very small. And if I take eta 0 to be very small, what happens here is that I assume this assumption for eta belongs to this region. And this one is very close to actually the generalized kernel of the adjoint of the linearized KdV equation operator. So actually, it can be written. Actually, this is very close to these two functions, phi sub c, and the integral of del c phi. And so this assumption can be basically can be interpreted like V is orthogonal to this mode and also to this mode. And if we compute the time derivative of this quantity and substitute this equation into the resulting equation, what we have is actually these two equations. And since L is explicitly written in the previous slide in this way, we actually have a PDE, get a PDE of C and X. And it's not so clear what we get, but diagonalizing the modulation equation, we can get some PDE, which is much better. Of course, I need to differentiate X in terms of X sub X, you think of X sub Y instead of X, because otherwise it's a wave equation and it's not so easy to approximate. But then if we think of the system of these two functions, we get a Burgers system with some remainder term. And diagonalizing this equation, we have this very good Burgers equation. And actually, this Burgers equation has satisfied the monotonicity formula like this one. So this is enough, actually enough to prove that the L2 norm of the remainder term V is almost conserved. And what we need to do is to something, the remainder term V remains in L2 in some L2 localized space. So this is what I need to do in the rest of the time. And what? For V1, it's very easy because it's a solution of it's a small solution of the KV2 equation. So I just need to use video identity written in the paper by Dunval and Martel. And we have this type of estimate. So for V1 part, we have this information. And for V And to do the rest of the analysis, I also need that L3 norm of V1 remains small. But this can be done by using the theory by Haddock, Haar, and Koff. Actually, they prove scattering for small solution to the KPT equation in the critical space. And using the bootstrapping argument, we can easily get a bound of this norm. And what I need to do is to estimate, have the estimate for this one. And to do this, I first truncate V2 in raw frequencies Y and apply the same group of FN for that part. And if I truncate V2 in low frequencies in Y, then it's almost an equation of 1D. So we can estimate this part by using the same group of estimate, exactly in the same way as Pegel Weinstein's paper. So it's quite easy. But for high frequencies, if we use a semi-group estimate, we face some sort of loss of derivatives. So to get rid of such a thing, you need to use Villier identity. So this is a Villier identity for V2. And there are some extra terms coming from potentials and some others. But since for this region, since we already know this type of estimates in low frequencies Y, what we need to do is to obtain the same sort of estimates for high frequencies Y. And for high frequencies in Y, if we use a Fourier transform to rewrite this part, then the symbol becomes something like this. And using the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, we have some estimate like that. And if we consider only high frequencies in Y, this means that this part is quite huge. So this part can be absorbed into this part. So in that way, we can prove that high frequencies in Y also belongs to this function space. And in that sense, we can prove a stability of line solitons. I think I want to stop talk here.
So if I understand well, you not only prove stability and asymptotic stability of initial line solitons, but also of initial distorted line solitons. If you take initial data?
I think so, yes.
So what would be the assumption that you would make on distortion that would be allowed somehow in the y direction?
I think this one is should be small, and also I haven't checked, but probably this. So I might be wrong, but I think this kind of assumption is enough. This should be very small.
I find it curious that a dispersive equation, you have some piece of the modeling using a dissipative Berger's equation.
Yes.
Now I know you derived that for us on slide number 22, I think it was, but that went by a little fast. So can you just describe it a little bit? Why you get Berger's? Maybe it was at 22, a little bit earlier. There, Berger's. No Berger's.
Oh, I see. Yes.
So why would you find dissipation in a dispersive equation?
I think there is an explanation in papers by Peterson, but I think dissipation is important. So this is a schematic picture of line solitons wave. Modulating line solitons wave. So this part becomes flatter and flatter as t goes to infinity. And this part cannot move because of the well posedness. Because otherwise, there should be some gap at least here. And what Miles did is that there is just a jump. And what Miles did is just to use wave equation to describe here. But Peterson later says that there should be, if you derive modulation equation more precisely, there should be deflection. So this shouldn't be something like jump, but there should be some heat equation to moderate here. And this part is expanding in the order of this. I think this is an observation made by Peterson. And that's what how high here appears. And also from the spectrum, to derive the modulation equation, I use orthogonality to these IMUs. And this is not on strictly on imaginary axis, but it curves like a parabola. So this is another.
A little bit the exponential weight.
Yeah. No, actually, those eigenmodes actually grows exponentially as x goes to minus infinity. So if you think of those eigenmodes in L2 space, it can never be a continuous spectrum.
More questions now? So thanks, speaker.